One of the wonderful things about history is being able to access church records, wills, diaries, letters, written evidence of people's struggles with this mortal life. The church has always been the keeper of statistics. In England, it is wonderful to be able to go back hundreds and hundreds of years to find when someone was baptized a certain day, a certain hour, by a certain priest in a certain parish. In America, the English church continued the same practice. Not everyone kept perfect records. We're all human, but there are wonderful examples of the daily life within the fabric of the church. And remember, the church did cover all of life, not just the baptism and the burial, but everything in between. The Bruton Parish records have great spaces where we don't have everything, partly because things got burned, partly because things got lost. To me, it looks almost like a mystery, as if someone really wanted to keep the information really quiet, because there are places where it looks like they've pulled out whole handfuls of pages, and I want to know what don't they want me to read. But it's wonderful to be able to find certain characters, whether they're famous or whether they're just regular everyday people. It appears that everybody from the very top to the very bottom was conscious of having their child baptized at Bruton Parish. And it also appears that many people had lots and lots of their enslaved folks baptized. We have pages and pages of evidence for that. It appears in one place where it happened every week for months. And sometimes they were baby slaves, sometimes they were grown persons, sometimes there's only a first name. But you can really pull together the fabric of the town by reading some of the names. There's a Joseph, son of Peggy, belonging to Colonel Custis's estate. You will remember that Colonel Custis was the first husband of Martha, who ultimately becomes Martha Washington. And then we find Jenny, daughter of Laffney, belonging to Colonel George Washington. So this would be someone that was in Mr. Washington's ownership. We have James Ragman, son of Judith, belonging to Thomas Hornsby. Hornsby is a very big name in Williamsburg in the colonial period and even through today. And Mr. Hornsby was probably one of the wealthiest merchants in town. I've been able to track his marriages and his property and his estate, and it was quite formidable. There are a number of other great names in our register. Burl, who are the family that owned Carter's Grove Plantation. Randolph, both John the Tory and Peyton. Waller, Carter, Blair, Horrocks, and that's a wonderful name. He was a minister and he was connected with the church and the college. There's a servant by the name of Jacca, J-A-C-C-A, and her master was a man by the name of Samuel Spur. He is the one who built the wall that went all around Bruton Parish. And then there's a interesting one, Lucy, daughter of Charlotte, and Charlotte, of course, belonged to the College of William and Mary. We need to remember that many, many, many people and institutions owned servant property. So the church owned enslaved people, as did the college, as did so many of the people who you met on the street every day.